All right, welcome to part two. We're going to start with question number 11. Why do doctors suggest that people get a flu vaccine each year? So remember, a virus, let's say this is our virus, has DNA inside. Now that virus attaches to a cell, and it injects its DNA into the cell. All right, so now that the viral DNA is inside the cell starts making viruses. So then we have multiple viruses, millions of viruses that are eventually going to escape from the cell and go infect new cells. But the thing is while this is happening, okay, mistakes can happen. Your cells make mistakes in their own DNA when they copy it, but usually it gets fixed. So a viral DNA could have a mistake in it. We call that a mutation. Now it could make it harmless. It could not change anything. It could make it more harmful. Okay, it could make it worse. So that's why you get a flu vaccine every year, because viruses mutate, they change. This is also why, you know, vaccinating as many people as possible is important, because every unvaccinated person is a possible point of mutation for the virus. Which of these organisms is a producer in a marine ecosystem? So remember, you have the sun, right? That's an abiotic source of energy. Then you have the producer, usually some kind of plant, might be a bacteria, might be an algae. Okay, but it's something photosynthetic, usually. Could be chemosynthetic if we're talking about the bottom of the ocean. Okay, and then you have a consumer, usually some kind of heterotroph, like might be a cow, might be a rabbit. But this says marine ecosystem. Remember, marine means ocean, right? So looks like we have three heterotrophs and one autotroph in our answer choices. You figure out which one it is, you'll have the answer. Which of these careers would a student studying biotechnology most likely pursue? So remember, biotechnology is using living things to fix problems. All right, so which one of these is most likely to involve living things? Number 14, which best determines the number of wolves that it can live in an area? All right, so remember, well, which one of these does a wolf need? Does a wolf need snow? No. Does a wolf need birds? No, they probably don't eat birds very often. They probably would eat one if they found it weak and with a broken wing on the ground, but they don't. It's not a main source of food. Okay, number of trees. I don't remember hearing that wolves live in trees. So that leaves the amount of food. Okay, and it's just like every other thing. You know, we talked about the deer. We took the wolves out, the deer overpopulated, ate up the food, and then there wasn't enough food. Same thing with the wolves. If the wolves overpopulate and eat all the rabbits, there's no more food for the wolves, right? So a lot of them starve. What happens to a population and to competition when there is a reduction in living space? All right, so we have a big forest with a bunch of predators and a bunch of consumers. Well, that's no big deal, okay? But if we take the same number of predators and we put them together in a smaller space, okay, they're in a smaller space. So that means the population contracts. It also means they're going to compete more often. So competition strengthens. So that's the answer. All right, kudzu vines grow by climbing and wrapping around trees. Kudzu, by the way, is an invasive species. The trees covered by the kudzu can die because they are starved of sunlight. All right, so this sentence, trees covered can die because they're starved of sunlight. What that translates to is the kudzu is better at getting, sunlight. Okay? What type of relationship exists between the trees and kudzu? All right, the kudzu is not eating the tree, so it's not a predator. The kudzu is not stealing sunlight from the tree. Like, it's not growing roots into the tree and sucking sunlight out of the tree. So it's not a parasite. It's not mutualism because the tree's dying, right? So what's happening when the kudzu is just better at getting a resource than the other one, okay? All right, here we have the food web. So we have the producers, autotrophs. We have the primary consumer, so let's see, the rabbit is a primary consumer, the mouse is a primary consumer, the grasshopper is a primary consumer, okay? The frog is a secondary consumer. The hawk is a secondary consumer. If you look at this line and this line, the hawk is a secondary consumer. I promise you I can spell. It's just half the time when I'm writing, I can't see what I'm writing because the computer is lagging because it's recording and writing. It's crazy. Anyway, but if we look at this line over here, the grasshopper is the primary consumer. The frog is a secondary consumer. That makes the hawk a tertiary consumer. All right? Where is the largest amount of energy found in the food web? All right, so remember, we have that energy pyramid, and the largest part of the pyramid was always the producers, and only 10% of their energy gets passed up. That's true of each level. It's always 10%. All right, so you tell me, where's the most energy? What do transitional fossils best support? So a transitional fossil would be one that it's like what they call the missing link, all right? So it's the biological evolution is what that shows. Tigers and household cats are members of the same family. However, their sizes are vastly different. What is the cause of this difference? Genetics. Why is a healthy diet important? A healthy diet supplies what your body needs to stay alive. All right. What happens to water molecules during the boiling process? All right. So again, boiling is the transition from liquid to gas. So as we said earlier, that means you gain energy. So if you're gaining energy, are you going to move faster or slower? Okay. And if you're moving faster, are you going to be closer together or farther apart? All right. If you want elements with similar properties, you're going to look for the same group. So look at the periodic table. You can go to ptable.com. Okay, in another tab, and look to see which ones of these are in the same group. If a chemical reaction such as photosynthesis begins with 6 atoms of carbon, how many atoms of carbon should be in the products? The law of conservation of mass says if you start with 6 atoms, you have to end up with 6 atoms. So that's the answer. All right, which is a possible disadvantage of using flowing water to produce electricity? All right, we talked about this before. You build a dam, right? So here's my dam. We've got the river flowing through it. And then behind it, we have this big, you know, man-made reservoir of water. So that means the ecosystem down here has less water, and it's flooded back here permanently, as long as that dam is there. All right, so there's ecosystem damage and loss of land. Let's see here. Why is it important for an aquifer more likely to be cleaner than water from other sources? Because the water is filtered by the rock and soil deep in the earth. But you got to remember too that that takes decades. Okay, we're not talking about, oh, I'm gonna, you know, pour some water out and it's gonna be ready to drink in like 2 days. No, we're talking decades for this process. All right, so that's it. I'll see you in part 3.